First of all, although he didn't have one.
Yeah, he has a loud voice.
Okay. So, first of all, thank you for making me be here. And always it's inciting to be a part of conferences because you have the opportunity to share your research with others and somehow discuss ideas and further your research as well. We have the chance with Albert to announce at the same time that the paper just got published from the Third World Quarterly, in print, so just one day before arriving at the conference. Before some of the details will be escaped because there is not much time to go through all we have been writing. A second thing, we are sending you to Balkans because previously it was about immigrant crisis, of course to Balkan and Balkan wars, all the new ones, and of course there are a lot of refugee crises going on during this war, as you may remember the recent one going in the 90s. And at the same time would like to understand and point to the fact that of course, facts are important and we need to know them, but in fact it's not that they have much in this making our representation regarding different topics. And third, I had the problem, and I discussed it with Albert, should we go via PowerPoints or should we go through reading some excerpts from the paper? And we decided to read it because there is a big debate, should PowerPoint, make lazy lecturers, and at the same time the public get absorbed by the PowerPoint and doesn't pay attention to much to all kind of variation that may take part during the presentation. So I'm going to read some of the parts in order to be good also with the time. So the main aim of this paper of us was to problematize the dominant narrative of Balkan wars in terms of performative practices. We assume that narratives that are told about this war are performed and practiced in a way that engage certain types of public representation in the Western European imagination of not only the Balkan wars, but Southeast Europe and its people as well. We analyze the performance of this narrative to attempt to understand how international representation of Southeast Europe has been constructed through the 20th centuries, starting with the old war of 1912-13 and going on up to the last wars during the 90s, mainly in Yugoslavia, has created some representation which has remained fixed in Western imagination as the present history, and they resonate with an historical and civilizational rhetoric that is linked to another othering process or politics of otherization. In particular, we highlight the inflated references to the atrocities of the Balkan Wars, which continue to dominate the narratives on current events in the region. Such exaggeration revive old stereotypes and indiscriminate essentialized generalizations related to non-European qualifications such as ancient hatred, violence, and uncivilization. Incidentally, a similar essentialist and timeless bias can be found also in debates in international relation theory as well, that a part of the paper addressed towards the end. After a brief theoretical background, we first explore various narrative legacies of Balkan War in order to understand the importance of discourse exerted by various ideological and political interests on the construction of Balkan international representation of Southeast Europe. The key types of narrative and their legacies comprise four types of narratives, which we name sensationalist, essentialist, securitist, and pacifist appeals. Taken together as a whole, they are a common feature of common of contemporary policy analysis in the dominant discursive practice of international politics and scholarship on the region. Second, we consider some contingent problematizations with respect to the to Balkan international representation of Southeast Europe, including the validity of claim in analytical approaches where historical knowledge is obtained from interplay of temporality and historicity, the instrumental function of idea and performative practices at play in the otherization process of the region. Lastly, we explore some problematic outcomes of Southeast Europe by being posited by Western observers and scholars as a security threat and the site of intervention. We also identify some of the reasons behind the international policy of commitment of containment of Southeast Europe and the theoretical confusion in international approach into Western modernization, Europeanization, and international security. Now to talk about a little bit about theoretical approach. In fact, we adopt the concept of international society of state, which is introduced by Hedley Bull, which is considered, according to referring to Durkheim, as an international society that is able to elaborate, like any other specific system, society, specific system of collective representation as an autonomous reality. This representation would substantiate the intellectual attitudes of the West international community, independently from the individual mental images and disposition of any actor in the system. A similar social theoretical view appears also in the writings of Alexander Wendt when he introduces the concept of collective representations as having a life of their own and logic, and which cannot be reduced to actors' perceptions or behavior. Of course, as we state, we have taken a socio-anthropological approach, so therefore you find here not only authors from international relations, but also from anthropologists, which from Taylor to Gertz and beyond in a powerful, and beyond in a powerful, complex and ongoing conceptualization of culture, which refer to an order system of acquired cognitive and system meanings and other resources of existence in terms of which social interactions take place, whereas society refers to the social organization of human life and the ongoing process and patterns of interactive behavior, the form that social actions take in the actually existing framework of social relation.
Thus,
I think it's okay.
Yes.
So after analysis of international representation as part of a cultural system that structure knowledge, we go in order to find how it is realized. We just go through different narratives, as I mentioned, to find those characteristics. And in fact, we see that there is an important dimension of a way that the Balkans are part presented through this international representation in a sensationalist representation, where different kind of so-called parachutist journalists dropped in the Balkans in the 90s and picked very sensational actors and events from the region in order to make a narration of the war that got the attention of the public, but not the problematic that were related with the conflict, and making associations with the old Balkan Wars of the beginning of the centuries, without without giving any justification that how this comparison can be taking place while we are talking about a part of the Balkan and not all the Balkans, because geographically, all Balkan War took part in included all the Balkans, and it was a movement of moving out the Ottoman Empire. Of course, maybe a historical background is needed, because not everybody is familiar with 1912 and 13 Balkan War, because they were in the prelude of the First World War and they were forgotten. But we see with the Yugoslav War in the 90s that a lot of references are made to this war. And the first were the journalists, which published a lot of successful books for the public, because they picked some very sensational events and stories. And the other ones are the ones which trade an essentialized narrative of this war, with transposing terms such as Balkan bubble, inferno, ghost, broken bones, tragedy, chaos, horror, slaughterhouse, third, other, to identify the wars in the 19th with the one which happened before, and as if nothing has changed during all this year from the 1913 to the late 80s. Of course, that another narrative which is told about the Balkan War is concerned with the security threats that come from these wars. And in fact, Balkan also is portrayed like the other that issue threats towards towards Europe, which goes online a little bit with the threats that are created about refugees that are flowing to Europe now recently. And in fact, those kind of security discourses defined also the Balkan as a source of aggressive nationalism, as the fire line between a civilized world and uncivilized war-prone civilization. And this one also essentialized the threats, and they rather created than responded to threats, because as we will see that this kind of position and understanding is related to the way you relate to the other. You may read further detail that the author which assumed such kind of narratives in the paper. And then the last one is the pacifist appeals. In fact, the most famous document about the old war is the causes and conduct of the Balkan War, which was a Carnegie report on this war, which was taken as it was and republished in the case of the new wars, in order to offer an understanding. So the meaning of publishing it was to offer an understanding, because nobody knew anything about the Balkans, which are next door Europe, but still they remain unknown to all the to all European next doors. And in fact, the problem with these pacific approaches is the exaggeration they issued regarding all atrocities and horrible aspects of war, which we will see that it was motivated by a noble intention, but at the end portrayed the region as something that is out of what we have in mind about a civilized Europe. Now, of course, that these narratives we consider the contingent of problematization. We subsume them to problematization, which in fact rely first on the validity of claims. A lot of research is done from Balkan scholar and not about what happened during the old war and the new wars, and a lot of facts are from archive research and from mainly from history from below approach to show what really represented the Balkan Wars, and we will see that there are variation in the way those wars were perceived at the time they happened, and of course, but in fact, what has those studies done, bringing facts showing that there has not been a homogeneous idea about this war, old war, as wars of attrition and based on ethnic hatred. Once they were considered as liberation wars because the Balkan countries were getting off the Ottoman Empire. But then with the Second War, we forgot that, and we get to those facts that show that how horrible this war was. Because showing the horror may teach to the other not to repeat the same mistakes. But we conclude that after looking so much to this to this claim, they haven't deconstructed the representation that are constructed about the Balkans. And we see that we find those kind of changes in some different performative practices that has to do with policies. We see the implication of different kind of policies towards the region. We have mentioned containment. The Balkans for long has been out of European agenda for integration because it is the other and we don't know and we have difficulties to include it. We see it in the policies of intervention, especially this literature has affected the delay intervention in Bosnia and letting the things to run up to the level where correction are very difficult. And the last one to the problem of European integration, which because of all this kind of representation of the Balkans, it is a reluctance of getting them into the European family and always keeping them as the other uncivilized, violent, and source of troubles and security issues. Of course, that we offer an approach that has to do with the understanding of collective representation as a part of a culture, but not culture in plural terms, but in single terms, which is a way of structuring knowledge, and somehow this will help us to understand our behavior. And in this understanding, of course, we consider that. What's important about culture is shaping identities of the actors that are involved. In this sense, we go not to the to the individual, but we see the region and confronting Europeans and the Balkans. And here to shape the identity, we consider that taking from constructivist theories, especially structuralist one, deconstructing the idea, so deconstructing the construction of the idea that what matters is the identity of the social identity of the actor and the corporate identity about the particular features somehow is someone headless, settled, essentialized, and it doesn't change. In fact, for us, what matters. For us, what matter is are the boundaries that are created through the process of interaction, where actors somehow put the boundaries that are not somehow are porous and change all the time. As it can be observable now, we don't know where borders of the Balkans are with regard to Europe, because Slovenia is part of European Union, Croatia is part of European Union, Bulgaria, Romania, Greece. So what is left of the Balkans? But still we talk about the Balkans as a homogeneous entity that has to be contained and to delay European integration. We talk a little bit also about, we explain why this attitude of Europe, and we use mythological rationalization, drawing from history of, drawing from Levi-Strauss theory about the theory of dismissing, about the history and the the history and role of myth in history. And we consider that, of course, Europe has invented tools up to the level of myths to cool down all the catastrophes that it has gone through, because it's not only Balkan that has gone through these catastrophes, and everybody knows in this audience, but with peace treaties, they have cooled down the devices, and somehow, by referring the other as worrisome, they somehow try to mythicalize the idea that this is somebody's, but this is somebody's else business, and we have these agreements, and we cool down, and we forget about all these kind of atrocities, and then we are peaceful, and the other is warful. So, in fact, more or less, this is what we have tried to explain to this this paper, that goes on the bunch of this literature that would like to deconstruct the constructed image about the region, and to inform policies about ways that would sort out this kind of impasse within Europe. We have problem with refugees, but in fact we have those problems in the Balkans. I'm concluding. We have the problems in the Balkans. If somebody is following policies in the Balkans recently, everybody is seeing that the situation is boiling, and the European Union somehow has lost legitimacy to settle issues. Although Mogherini went in the Balkans, nobody listened to her, neither in Macedonia, nor in Kosovo, nor in Serbia. So this kind of representation and boundaries between the Balkans and the Europe has to be destroyed one and forever, and somehow to bring peace in Europe. And I'm not taking responsibility about the other parts, because other will somehow bring attention. I'm willing to ask a question to maybe elaborate further some ideas that were shortly mentioned in these 20 minutes. It's a 25-page paper, so very difficult to say all. Thank you very much for your attention.
I'm going to have to ask the speakers to stick to the 20 minutes, because actually we normally have 15 minutes for the presenters. And then there has to be at least some half an hour for the discussion. That is the rule of the conference. Now, given the fact that we have